Hello to you, friends. This is Stammer on air, but first, the daily, early Buddhist contemplation. All beings are born and created by their karma. They are formed, shaped, conditioned, elevated, and restricted by their karma. These past actions, this past behavior, is the womb of probability from which they reemerge. All beings are owners of their karma, debtors to their karma, and they inherit their karma. Whatever they do, whether good or bad, the later effects of that will be theirs only. This accumulation of probability follows them like a shadow of the past that never leaves. Therefore does this karma come to divide all beings into high and low, beautiful or ugly. To improve this karmic accumulation, it is therefore crucial to go for refuge in the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha. And to improve behavior, accept and undertake the five basic Buddhist training rules. Doing so by repeating these following stanzas defines any Buddhist and is the very entry point into the Sangha, the community of Buddhist disciples. The verbal device for taking the three refuges and accepting the five precepts goes like this. As long as this life lasts, I hereby take refuge in the Buddha. I hereby take refuge in the Dhamma. I hereby take refuge in the Sangha. I hereby seek shelter in the Buddha for the second time. I hereby seek shelter in the Dhamma for the second time. I hereby seek shelter in the Sangha for the second time. I hereby request protection from the Buddha for the third time. I hereby request protection from the Dhamma for the third time. I hereby request protection from the Sangha for the third time. The three refuges is hereby taken. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all killing. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all stealing. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all sexual abuse. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all dishonesty. I hereby accept and undertake the training rule of avoiding all alcohol and drugs as long as this life lasts. From now on, I can hereby rightly consider myself to be a true Buddhist with the blessed Buddha as my teacher. This Sangha entry can be verified at the Sattama Sangha or Sangha entry page at the website whatbuddhasaid.net. Thank you for your understanding and participation.
Hello to you, friends. This is Damme on Air number 204. And we're back into the Danish forest. And this day we talk about only one thing, the five clusters of clinging, which is clinging to form, clinging to feeling, clinging to perception, clinging to mental construction, and clinging to consciousness itself. But let's first put up the camera. Hello to you, friends. This is Damme on Air number 104. There's one question, one very important core question on the five clusters of clinging, the five khandhas, the five aggregates. Same thing, but first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. It's question 324, and thank you for it, because it's a very good question. Are the five aggregates, the five clusters of clinging, the five khandhas, are they objects of insight meditation, vipassana? Yes, indeed. They are the prime object of insight meditation. You can say the Buddha, he operated with different classification schemes of everything for different people. Those who are most intelligent, they would understand it with a basic dualism called nama rupa, mind and matter, basically, or minding and mattering. And it is the most sharp could take it from there. Then those of us not so sharp, they can take it, the analysis, up with the five aggregates. For these two classifications, are all of them, are all inclusive, if you take internal and external. So it's a different way of cutting the cake. The next step is to take, if less quick, less ability to understand, then one will teach the same thing regarding the six senses and the six sense objects. The eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue, the body and the mind, and correspondingly visual objects, smellable objects, tasteable objects, touchable objects and thinkable objects. This is all, he would say. Or if not that, then there's 18 elements, the 18 dhatus, which is the six senses, the six sense objects, and corresponding plus corresponding the six kinds of consciousness: visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, olfactory consciousness, gustatory consciousness, tactile consciousness, and mind consciousness. But this is, I think, the five clusters of clinging, the five khandhas, the five aggregates, are the most normal and also the one I use myself all the time to classify phenomena in the so-called world or in the so-called being. And this also goes for other beings, internally and externally. What are the five clusters of clinging? They are the cluster of clinging to form, rupakanta, internal form, external form, past, present or future form. Clinging to that is a cluster of clinging to form. Others' bodies are external form. One's own body is internal form. Mountains are external form. Trees are external form. Past, present and future. Future world is, anything in the future world is future form, if not alive. There's a duck. The cluster of clinging to form, one. The cluster of clinging to feeling, vedana, kanda, is clinging to pleasant feeling, painful feeling, and neutral feeling. Internal, external, one's own feelings, others' feelings, past, present, and future. And clinging to feelings you had when you were a child, or when you were in love, or clinging to feelings that you expect to get in the future, pleasure, for example, that you expect to get from a new object, a new car, or a new house, or a new lover, or a new job, or whatever. Three, the cluster of clinging to perception, sanya kanda. There are also six kinds of perception. Cluster of clinging to construction, mental construction, sankara kanda. This is clinging to hopes, plannings, intentions, particular moods as happiness, but also constructions out in the world. They're all mental constructions, you can say, mental constructs, except Nibbana. Clinging to that, others' hopes, others' expectations, for example, is clinging to the cluster of cluster of clinging to construction, sankara kanda. And the last one is clinging to consciousness itself, to have visual consciousness, and to enjoy, to hear something, smell something, touch something, and use the so-called specific tactile or auditory or visual or gustatory consciousness. This one, of course, also clings to. If one clings to the food, then actually it's not the food itself. It is the feeling of good taste and the consciousness related with it one clings to. What is clinging? Yeah, clinging, what's the cause of clinging? It comes from craving. From contact comes feeling. From feeling comes craving. From craving comes clinging. So it is a cementified form of clinging. A form of craving, sorry. And since craving is the cause of suffering, according to the Second Noble Truth, then even more is clinging also a cause of suffering. It is because one cannot relinquish the object. And since the object is impermanent, then one always loses grasp to it. One cannot cling to something that is impermanent. So that's why you feel sorrow. It's not the form, feeling, perception itself that is suffering. It is the clinging to it that is suffering. On stilling of all clinging, the Blessed Buddha, he said, the fading away, silencing, stilling, ceasing, and bringing to an end of all feeling, of all perception, of all mental construction, and of all consciousness. Only this pacification completely eliminates all suffering, ends all disease, and fully overcomes all decaying, all sickness, all aging, and all death. The silencing, pacification of this clinging, the release of it, ends all suffering. Samyutta Nikaya 22.3. So again, the explanation of these five clusters of clinging is that the cluster of clinging to form is clinging to one's own body and to others' body, or what's appearing out there as the physical world. This is a cluster of clinging to form, rupa, rupa kanda. The cluster of clinging to feeling is this obsession we have with pleasant feeling. We only want pleasant feeling. And the fear of panic on painful feeling, and the obstinate indifference towards anything that invokes neutral feeling. This is a cluster of clinging to feeling. The cluster of clinging to perception is a monomaniac obsession with diverse and momentarily tantalizing manifold objects of the six senses. So anything you can see, hear, taste, touch, think. So this covers more or less anything you can call entertainment, or anything that can be sensed and induce this tantalizing pleasure which minds look after all the time. The cluster of clinging to construction is a persistent passion for intending, planning, attending, thinking, involving, hoping, wanting, willing, and worrying, among other things. So this is sankara, mental construction. It's a really broad term that covers a lot of land. But the prime driver in construction is this intention and any derivatives of it, like hoping, planning. The cluster of clinging to consciousness is the addiction to all that is seen, heard, smelled, tasted, touched, and cognized as ideas and mental states. There's nothing outside these five clusters of clinging. So you can practice for yourself and say, what is the forest? This is external form. What is the body? This internal form. What was the baby I was 57 years ago? That was internal form, past internal form. What is the death body? This thing will become into in some time. It is future internal form, and so forth. So classifying all the time, classifying all the time. Since it's an all-inclusive classification, there's not any phenomena in the world that you cannot put into these five clusters of clinging. So the Buddha say, in short, when under the first noble truth, in short, these five clusters of clinging are suffering. And again, it's not the objects, it's the clinging to them that is the suffering. So it covers all worldly phenomena. This process, the Buddha likened to mental imprisonment, because the clinging and the suffering is not out there, it is in the mind, of course. And he said like this, imagine, friends, a dog tied with a strap to a strong post. It would remain running and circling around that very post. So indeed too, the unlearned ordinary person who regards form as self, who regards feeling as self, who regards perception as self, who regards consciousness and constructions as self. He keeps whirling and spinning around these five clusters of clinging. Furthermore, if that dog walks, stands, sits down or lies down, it all does that quite close to that very same post. Runs around the post. Exactly too does the untrained ordinary person who regards form thus, this is mine, this I am, this is myself. And who regards feeling, perception, mental constructions, and consciousness thus, this is mine, this I am, this is myself. If he walks, he walks like close to that very same five clusters of clinging. If he stands or if he sits down or lies down, he always does that, as if locked and chained to these five clusters of clinging. As bound, he keeps running and circling around feeling, around form, around perception, around mental construction and around consciousness. Since he keeps on rotating and spiraling around them, he's neither freed from form, nor freed from feeling, nor freed from perception, nor freed from mental construction, nor is he freed from consciousness. I tell you, it is therefore that neither he is freed from birth, aging, decay, nor death. Neither is he freed from sorrow, pain, lamentation, frustration, nor all forms of desperate despair. Neither is he freed from this entire mass of suffering. Samyutta Nikaya, the group sayings of the Buddha, book 22, Sutta 99-100. So at one who is keeps circling around these five objects of clinging, these five clusters of clinging, these five khandhas, he's like a dog tied to a post. He cannot get away from it. And therefore he cannot get away from suffering. At Savatthi, seated to one side, a certain bhikkhu asked the Blessed One, is there, Venerable Sir, any form or any feeling or any perception or any mental construction or any consciousness that is permanent, stable, eternal, not a changing state that will remain the same just like eternity itself? Then the Blessed One took up a bit of soil on his little fingernail. I said to that bhikkhu, bhikkhu, there's not even this much form, feeling, perception, construction and consciousness that is permanent, stable, eternal, not subject to change, that will remain the same just like eternity itself. If there was such, just this much form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness that was permanent, stable, eternal, and not changing. This living of the noble life for the utterly complete elimination of all suffering could not be made known. Could not be made known. So he says it's because that it is, there is no nothing out there nor in here, in these five clusters of clinging that is stable, that can be relied upon. Neither the world, nor the body, nor the mind. Anything mental or physical, anything conditioned, cannot be relied upon. But because there is not even this much form, feeling, perception, mental construction, nor consciousness that is stable, permanent, eternal, not subject to change. This living of the noble life for the complete elimination of all suffering can indeed be made known. So the noble life is definable and practicable because of this fact. Because one cannot rely upon anything for one's happiness, for one's safety, for one's absence of suffering. It's not possible, simply. It's also from Samyutta Nikaya, book 22. There's a whole Kanda Samyutta on this subject. So it's really important. A whole book in the collected or grouped Samyutta Nikaya sayings of the Buddha. Here comes one more. The Blessed Buddha once said, "Friends, whoever were recluse or priest now, in the past or in the future regards whatever is pleasant and attractive there is in this world as permanent, as lasting, as happiness, as self, as healthy, as secure, only stimulates craving. By stimulating craving, they long, thirst, and hunger, thereby inducing production of sense desires, production of defilements, production of intentions, hopes, wishes, plans, and productions of the five clusters of clinging. By nurturing uptake of such accumulation of fuel for becoming and fuel for existence, they indeed provoke continuation. Thus, provoking prolongation, they are neither freed from birth, nor from decay, nor from aging, nor from freed from death. They are therefore not released from sorrow, from depression, from despair, from misery, from pain, from frustration, from discontent, nor from hopelessness. I tell you, they are not freed from neither the present nor any future form of suffering. But friends, whoever recluse or priest now, in the past or in the future, regards whatever is pleasant and attractive in this world as impermanent, as transient, as suffering, as no self, as a disease, as danger, as fearful, as empty terror, they thereby reduce all craving. After having gradually eliminated all craving, I tell you, they are freed from all suffering." The group sayings of the Buddha, Samyutta Nikaya 2, Sutta 109-12. So, on seeing these five clusters of clinging, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness collectively, as impermanent, as painful, as a disease, as a boil, as a dart, as a calamity, an affliction, as alien, remote, as disintegrating, as a plague, as a terror, as a menace, as a disaster, as fickle, as perishable, as not lasting, as transient, as no protection, no shelter, no refuge, as empty, as vain and void, as no self, as danger, as subject to change, as having no core, as a root of ruination, as murderous, as due to be annihilated, as subject to fermentation, as constructed of parts, as martyr's bait, as subject to birth, subject to aging, subject to illness, subject to death, subject to sorrow, subject to lamentation, subject to despair, and subject to defilement. By seeing that these five clusters of clinging are impermanent, one thus acquires a fondness, an inclination, a preference that conforms with the Dhamma. By seeing that ceasing of the five clusters of clinging is a very immutable Nibbana, one enters into the certainty of rightness. This is therefore perfectly right view. Patita Sambhita Magga by Sariputta. 2.238. The Buddha, he likened in a famous sutta where he saw some bubbles coming down the Ganges. He likened this to bubbles, these five clusters of clinging, in the following way. The Buddha once said, form is like a lump of foam. Feeling is like a water bubble. Perception is like a mirage. Construction is like a hollow tree. And consciousness like an illusion. Just a call is appearance. However, one may reflect over it and carefully investigate. When one views it cautiously, it all appears as empty and void. Pointing at this body, the one of broad vision has taught that if only three things are lacking, one will have to leave this fragile frame, ditched all behind. If metabolism, heat and consciousness depart from this physical body, then it lies there, cast away, unconscious food for others. This illusion, beguiler of vain fools, is similar to a serial killer. It follows right behind you. Neither a substance nor any safety. A bhikkhu with a roused enthusiasm looks upon these five clusters of clinging in exactly this ultra-realistic way. Disgusted, both day and night, ever aware, calmly and clearly comprehending, he should eliminate all mental chains, thereby making his own island, thereby becoming his own protector, refuge, lamp and light. Let him train as with a head ablaze, with fire yearning only for the everlasting deathless state. The group sayings of the Buddha, Samyutta Nikaya 342. So you can see it is because of clinging to these five clusters of clinging that one runs around in spiral in samsara. One keeps coming back to it. Because one clings to it because one is attracted to it and mistake it for something lasting, permanent, trustable. There is a cluster of clinging to feeling. Feeling is just like a water bottle because it lasts only for an instant. Bloop, then it's gone. There's a cluster of clinging to form, rupa. It's like a six room since it will develop into a sick thing that has to go to the hospital and eventually die. The cluster of clinging to perception, sanya, is like a mirage because it causes an illusion. One thinks there is a solid object in there. It's only an image, a representation, photographed either by the eyes or the other senses. It's not the object itself. Collectively, these five clusters of clinging is like an enemy with a drawn sword. It follows right up behind you. And if one moment of unawareness is there, then chop, the head falls off. The blessed Buddha once explained. Friends, form is burning. Feeling is burning. Perception is burning. Mental constructions are burning. And consciousness itself is burning. Burning with what? I should just say the context of this is that he preaches this to a number of ascetics that has been fire worshippers. So he thought this to teach through the medium of fire, of burning something, would be very suitable. And indeed they become arahant very, very shortly after the sutta was preached to them. Form is burning, feeling is burning, perception is burning, mental construction is burning, and consciousness itself is burning. Burning with what? Burning with greed, burning with hate, burning with ignorance, burning with rebirth, burning with aging, burning with decay, burning with sickness and pain, burning with death. I tell you, burning with suffering. Understanding this fully, friends, the learned noble disciple is disgusted with all form, disgusted with all feeling, with all perception, with all construction, his disgust even with consciousness itself. The experience of this disgust produces disillusion and disenchantment. Through this disillusion, the mind is completely released from all habituated attachment and tenacious clinging. When it thus is thus entirely liberated, when this assurance then appears to the noble, this mind is fully and irreversibly freed. And one instantly understand the rebirth cycle is now finally ended. This noble life has been completed. Done is what should be done. There's no state of being beyond this. So this puts it down is because of being attracted to the five clusters of clinging, one clings to them. Being the opposite of disgusted is disgusted by it. If one is disgusted by form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, because one sees them as a danger, as a cancer, as a serial murder, as something fearful, then mind is released because it detaches from the object. This attraction is not there. There's the opposite force, repulsion from this disgust. And thereby mind is released. Released. It can go wherever it wants. It's not like the dog that is tied to a post that can only go around these five clusters of clinging until it eventually becomes tired, sick, old, and dies. The mind is released. And it's released by this disillusion. That the objects, though the objects are completely the same as before, but now it doesn't mistake the object as being happiness because of knowing the Four Noble Truths. That these five clusters of clinging are indeed suffering. Because the Blue Buddha said, there are these Four Noble Truths. What for? The Noble Truth of suffering, the Noble Truth and the cause of suffering, the Noble Truth on the end of suffering, and the Noble Truth on the way to end suffering. This is the Four Noble Truths. What, bhikkhus and friends, is the first Noble Truth of suffering? These five clusters of clinging are suffering. The cluster of clinging to forms is suffering. The cluster of clinging to feelings is suffering. The cluster of clinging to perception is suffering. This cluster of clinging to construction is suffering. And the cluster of clinging to the six kinds of consciousness is suffering. This is the first Noble Truth on suffering. What, bhikkhus and friends, is the second Noble Truth on the cause of suffering? It is this craving which leads to renewed becoming, joined with delight and lust, seeking delight now here and later there. That is craving for sensual pleasures, craving for becoming, for example, rich, and this craving for not becoming, for example, sick, that is indeed the second Noble Truth on the cause of suffering. What now, bhikkhus and friends, is the third Noble Truth on the ceasing of suffering? It is the traceless fading away and complete ceasing of that very same craving. The giving up and relinquishing of it, the freedom from it, the non-dependence on it. This is actually the third Noble Truth on the ceasing of all suffering. What then is the fourth Noble Truth on the way leading to the ceasing of suffering? It is solely this Noble Eightfold Way, namely right view, Sammaditti, right motivation, Sammasankappa, right speech, Sammavaja, right action, Samma Kamanta, right livelihood, Samma Ajiva, right effort, Samma Vajama, right awareness, Samma Sati, and right concentration, Samma Samadhi. This is the fourth Noble Truth on the way leading to the ceasing of suffering. These, bhikkhus and friends, are the Four Noble Truths. Therefore, bhikkhus and friends, an effort should be made much of so to completely understand this is suffering, this is the cause of suffering. this is the end of suffering, and this is the way leading to the end of suffering. An effort should be made to understand, comprehend, penetrate, recognize, and realize these four noble truths. It's also Samyutta Nikaya, five Satya Samyutta on the clusters. So you, as you can see, it's a part of the first noble truth. That the first noble truth simply states that, in short, these five clusters of clinging are suffering itself. This can be practiced doing what we call the 18 great insights, Mahavipassana, or the 18 principal insights, which they lead to, and which is something that signifies the consummation, the completeness of understanding and perceiving, comprehending what these five clusters of clinging is, basically, and what their function is in samsara. These five principal insights, Mahavipassana, is seeing that all five clusters of clinging, all five aggregates, all five khandhas, that is any form, any feeling, any perception, any mental construction, and any consciousness, whether internal, external, past, present, or future, always was and ever will remain impermanent, only suffering, empty, not a part of any self, me or mine. This profound, shattering insight is induced in 18 ways, which goes as follows. Reflection on impermanence leaves the illusion of permanence. 1. 2. Reflection on pain renounces the misapprehension of pleasure. 3. Reflection on no self evaporates the imagination of a myself. 4. Reflection on dispassion and disillusion abandons naive delight. 5. Reflection on disgust eradicate voracious and insatiable greed. Can never be satisfied. Sense pleasure, for example, the more you eat, drink, and enjoy sex, drugs, and rock and roll, the more greed arises for it because of habituation and addiction. 6. Reflection on ceasing, desist from blind and initiating origination. Everybody wants to begin something. But actually, the way to lasting happiness is to end it all. To stop it all, to silence it all, to still it all. It's the exact opposite of beginning something new, which is basically craving for becoming. Bhavatana. Reflection on relinquishment releases the lock of grasped clinging. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Don't fear, let it go. Reflection on fragility leaves the misconception of compact solidity. 9. Reflection on the breakup of all constructions stops accumulation. If you know that all constructions fall apart, then you don't pick them up and accumulate them on your bank account or in your house or in your mind, let's say. You don't, because it will break up anyway, disappear. 10. Reflection on change ends the deception of any lasting contingency. If there's change, then there's this impermanence. And this impermanence, if there's then clinging to the same object that is impermanent, that is vanishing by itself, and is of a nature to vanish, then of course there will be sorrow. Before there's sorrow, before the object starts falling apart, before the body comes old, or before the lover leaves, or before the money is used, then there's panic and fear that it will happen. Because mind knows, of course, that it will happen eventually. 11. Reflection on the signless eliminates the captivating appearance of a sign. Imagine you are meditating, and then suddenly there's all still in mind. There's no objects, there's no signs, there's no appearances, there's no memories, there's no symbols. There's basically nothing. Then this nothing is the signless. And this is really captivating, because this is grounded in a deep, deep form of peace. A deep, deep form of stilling. And there, right after that peace and that ceasing, then comes this happiness, this profound happiness of being happy for nothing, basically. Being happy by absence of disturbance, of appearances, reflections, mirror images coming in from the past. Reflection on the desireless diminishes the feverish urge within our craving. The desireless, the signless and the desireless. Reflection on voidness erases the insistence on the self-deception, I am. That there is an I who am something. Basically, these five clusters of clinging is often used as a substitution of the concept of I. So what is really, what exists really, is this five clusters of clinging. If you put them together, you can call it a person or a world. But if you take them apart, then they are these, just these five clusters of clinging. Just like you, if you have a car and it's collected in all its parts, tires, wheels, engine and so on, you call it a car. But when you analyze the objects and take the wheels off and totally disassemble the car, then you don't call it a car anymore. You call it tires, wheels, motor and so on. Same thing here. Reflection on higher understanding uproots clinging to the fixed idea of a core. One sees the substancelessness of the physical world and the egolessness of the so-called individual. That releases. Reflection on direct knowledge and vision removes confused misinterpretation. Reflection on danger, adinama, extirpates the false assumption of reliance on the unstable. Reliance on form, reliance on feeling, reliance on perception, mental construction and consciousness, which is itself not only not lasting, but only momentary, all of them, blinking very fast. Reflection on resolute contemplation shelves the neglect of non-contemplation. So as soon as one doesn't want to think about it, doesn't want to reflect about it, doesn't want to meditate about it, doesn't want to study it, doesn't want to follow up on it, then one is insisting on non-contemplation, non-reflection. And this has a price. It's a resolute determination to reflect on these things that gives the release. Reflection on turning away exterminates mistaken insistence on self-bondage. Turning away from the world towards Nibbana. Turning away from samsara towards Nibbana. This then gets the dog out the leash. The bound being not whirling around, turning around the five clusters of clinging. The cluster of clinging to form. The cluster of clinging to feeling. The cluster of clinging to perception. The cluster of clinging to mental construction. And the cluster of clinging to consciousness. That's what keeps beings in samsara. This clustered clinging. So much for today. Remember to click subscribe down in the corner there. Turn your mobile phone, there's a small red sign down in this corner. Click subscribe there, because subscription to this channel is your ticket to Nibbana. Thank you to all the supporters, diakas and donors, especially those who support with a regular donation. This helps me here in Denmark, where the price level is very high. And not the least, the usual intro exit thing. Name. Tassu. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. Thank you for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thank you.
What then is happiness? Happiness is the stilling, the ceasing, the appeasing, the silencing, and the release from by relinquishment, all this cluster of clinging to form, to feeling, to perception, to mental construction, and to consciousness. That peace, that ceasing, ending of all clinging, is indeed happiness. Thank you for your attention and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.